Hello, everybody. My world is very exciting. You know, I love Schomburg because I'm getting to know lots of different people and lots of exciting places. And I'm here today to explore this new world in the company of Chuck Corona. You may know him, you may not know him. But hey, Chuck, before I go any further, you know, given we're distanced and everything, do you feel comfortable with us removing our masks? Okay then, let's take our masks off and then hopefully you'll be able to understand us more clearly as well. You know, I've been here in Church of the Holy Spirit for like 5 or 6 months, and I keep meeting lots of different people. And Chuck is one of those extraordinary people. If you don't know him, I'd like you to know him. What I've realized in our parish is that you don't know all each other. Everybody doesn't know each other. You know some people, but not all of them. And maybe by getting to know Chuck today, you'll know somebody new. So, Chuck Corona, I'm in your house today. Tell me, really, what am I standing in the middle of? What's all this that's going on around me?
This is a village, winter village I built from scratch for the last 10 years. These are all the houses and the airplanes and the lights. There's a town which I call Downtown Corona. There is a village, a winter village of Corona, and then there is a village of Corona. And it consists of 8 tables, 4 by 8 foot tables.
As I talk, I'm actually stood with Downtown Corona right behind me, and it's a bit noisy, but it's a downtown, so what do you expect? You know, we have trains, we have cars, you know, there are bars open, there's a whole full of life, and I'm just kind of blown away by the whole arrangement. This is in the basement of Chuck's home, and it just occupies the whole of the space, and I look forward, we'll show you during our conversation, the different parts. So Chuck mentioned the winter village and then the Corona village that's got like a carnival, kind of like family fest kind of arrangement too, which we're going to investigate. But Chuck, you said this, you started this 10 years ago. So I mean, what gave you the idea? Were you looking for a hobby, or did you come across it by accident? Because this is like a huge endeavor, you know, which really requires commitment and a certain sense of creativity and a certain understanding of engineering. Putting all this together with wires and cables and space is quite a feat. So, you know, what gave you the idea, or who gave you the idea?
I just seen houses that were for sale, like at Kohl's, so I started it, and in my first house, I had a back porch, which in the winter time I closed it up with plastic, and I put the village up, and then it just kept growing year after year.
So, let me get this right. You're shopping in Kohl's, right? Yeah. And just out of the corner of your eye, you see, oh, they're kind of interesting little houses, those villages. And just from just seeing that, you thought to yourself, well, I could start to do something like that. And from there, it just grew. It just grew. Now, I don't want to talk money, but I mean, was this an expensive operation? I mean, have you spent your life savings on putting this together?
It started where I was paying $60 or $70 per house, but in the last 4 years, I've been going garage selling, and I've been buying them for $5 a piece.
Well, that sounds like quite a bargain. I mean, frankly, and if anybody out there has any of these little village houses and you want to sell them to Chuck for $5, you know, I'm sure Chuck can find room for another table of them. But I mean, I wouldn't like to say how many houses are actually in here. Do you know the exact number?
About 160.
160 houses. That's not counting trains.
About 200 cars.
200 cars.
Many people walking around. I have a dog show at the end with a bunch of dogs.
A dog show. I'm looking at that now from the corner of my eye. I'll go and take a look shortly and see what Jonah thinks. But I mean, so dog shows, and even like the street lights. I mean, if you've got like 160 houses, you must have at least, you know, 160 street lights.
16, 20. Yeah, there's about 24 per table.
24 per table. That's well, I can't do the math. But
and
I
there's
mean,
seven tables.
Well, there you are. Do your sums, and you can work out what that is. But obviously, this started and it grew. And as you showed people what you were doing and they became enthusiastic about it, did that like encourage you to just making it grow?
Oh yes.
More and more?
Yes, it was a hobby. It became a big, big hobby for me.
It became a big, big hobby. And do you have any other plans to make it grow further? Would you do another kind of village? Or have you exhausted all the village opportunities?
Well, I don't know where I can put another table, to be honest.
Oh. Well, and maybe you'll just have to take up another room, you know.
But
there you are. You can move out a cabinet or something like that. We're just going to walk around towards the dog show, and so I can take a closer look and see what's going on there. So we're moving away from out of downtown now. You know, we're moving more into the suburbs. This is like the Coronaburg that we're moving into.
And
it's still downtown. Big place is Corona. My goodness, and I can see plenty of animals there. Oh yeah, there's lots of them. I can see Cocker Spaniels and Poodles. Yeah, I can see Pugs and Bulldogs. There's even one that maybe looked like a Shih Tzu, you know, but we can take a closer look later on. So this became obviously a big hobby of your life, you know, really. And you know, it's called Corona because Corona is your last name, right? You know. And so it just made me wonder when I learned that what your last name is Corona, do you have any like Latino roots or Italian roots?
It's Italian.
Oh, so your roots are Italian. So tell us about yourself. Where are you from originally?
I'm originally from Chicago.
Okay, what neighborhood?
North Side. All North Side.
All the North Side.
Yes.
Whereabouts?
Well, I started around Lincoln Park.
Yeah.
Then I moved to Clyburn and Diversity in the projects.
Okay.
And then I moved further west, Milwaukee, and then I lived in Franklin Park for a while with my sister's house.
Yeah.
And then I moved out to Streamwood.
Okay, into Streamwood, into this neighborhood where you are now in Hoffman Estates, right? This is... is close by, but not, yeah. But so how long have you been in this area, would you
50
say?
50 years.
50 years, okay. And so you moved out here with your late wife, okay. And your family, were they all brought up here?
My family was all from Chicago.
Okay. Yeah.
Except my grandmother was in Chicago. I have a famous uncle.
Oh, really?
Julius LaRosa, the singer.
Julius LaRosa. I don't know him, but he's somebody I'll look up on YouTube or Wikipedia when I get
yes.
back home.
Yes.
Okay, so that's, yeah. So sort of Italian is like your cultural heritage,
yes.
really.
More Italian. My mother was German, but my father was Italian.
With Italian. There you go. Yes. Yeah. So did you grow up kind of like learning a bit of Italian or not?
No, he never taught us any other way. I wish I would have, but
ah.
no.
What about the food, the mangia? I mean,
Now the food, I am a cook myself,
ah.
and I know that a lot of people here know my lasagna.
I just have to mention that because that is kind of a significant point. If you don't know Chuck, then you must know that his name is sort of the equivalent to lasagna, and very good lasagna. And I know that he feeds many of us in the parish, in the neighborhood. We receive like food care packages once a month, and he makes a very, very good lasagna. Now, is that your recipe, or did you get it from somewhere else?
It's my recipe.
Okay, tell us about it then. You know, what is the secret to it? Because I know it's kind of not too... It
changes every month.
Okay.
Because I do something different every month when I'm making it. It's never the same. My sauce is cooked for 8 hours with a pork roast in it. And then afterwards I grind the pork up to put into the lasagna, and I cook the Italian sausage, and then that goes in through it, and then I mix pepperoni with both the pork and the Italian sausage. So I make 4 different lasagnas every month.
What got you cooking lasagna in such big quantities?
Well, I learned from my mother the only way to make it is in big quantities.
Always
cook the big pot. And that's the way I was taught, and that's the way I make it now.
Okay, so the only way... Get that. The only way to make lasagna is in big quantities. Yeah. I can understand that. I can see why that is. You know, do you like eating it yourself?
Oh yes, I do that, and I keep the. I also make so much of it. I make actually 12 packages of that I pass out, and I use the sauce for my own spaghetti and sauce too.
Wow! So you make 12 lasagnas a month?
Yes.
Who does that? I mean, who makes 12 lasagnas a year? I mean, I know it's quite labor intensive, you know, and it takes a certain, I think, dedication and love to do that. So I just want to say I admire what you're doing. I'm very grateful too, because I benefit from it along with other people as well. But obviously you enjoy cooking.
Yes.
And now is that like, would you say that's also become a hobby, or have you always cooked?
I've always cooked. My wife was a decent, she wasn't as good as I was.
Isn't that great?
But she cooked, but she didn't make as much as I did. I take more interest in cooking myself.
Yeah. So I know that you make lasagna, but do you kind of like branch out and make other recipes as well? I mean, are you always exploring, looking for new things to do, or do you stick to the same things that you always make?
No, I make a delicious corned beef. I make cookies.
Oh, yeah.
All kinds of cookies. You've got one. I got one for you guys. And I pass them out, too.
The next thing I was going to say, that he's also quite an accomplished baker. And I've sampled some of his cookies, and I know they're very, very, very good. So we look forward to sampling those later on, you know. And again, you bake because you love to bake, and because, you know, you like to give to other people as well, you know. That's a great talent, you know, really. It's a great talent for such a young man. Do you mind me asking you about your age?
I turned 83 this year.
83 this year. This man, you know, he's created this world down in his basement, which is quite amazing. He's got a mat at the door that says, you know, his man cave, but I mean, this is not a man cave. This is another world. And he also, he cooks for like multiple people each month, and he gives away cookies. I mean, you know, how accomplished is that really? My dad is just about to turn 83 as well. And he's always very active, and I know that I think the secret of my own dad's kind of well-being is the fact of, like, you keep yourself going, you keep yourself occupied and what have you, and we're seeing this here really today. So I'm just, you know, in awe, really. It's a wonderful thing. I'm just glad that we have all of this on film so people can experience a bit of the world that's down here. I think maybe we should go towards like the winter village here, because I want to take a look at the ski slope, you know, and because you got the ski slope here, and there's all sorts of, like, you know, there's giants here, and there's lighthouses, and this thing, most of all, is like a skating rink, you know. So it's quite the thing. We have a covered bridge as well. And we have the skiers going up and down. I'm really quite amazed. Jonah is on the floor here, but I know that if he was, if I could pick him up and show him, he'd probably want to sort of have a walk around there, but he would destroy it all too. So, did you have to like do like a sketch of this design before you put it together, or did you just sort of say, well, I've got this bunch of houses now, I'll stick them together like this? I mean, was it how planned was it in its kind of architecture, or was it just kind of something you just did by instinct?
Just by instinct as I was buying them.
Yeah.
In the last 4 years, I probably got more than half of them what I got here. I just got in the last 4 years, picking them up from the garage sale.
Wow, that's amazing. And the other thing I wanted to ask you about was like your electric bill. Has it gone up, or does it, you know? I mean, how much does this burn a lot of electricity, you know, really, or is it kind of minimal?
It's kind of minimal because it only goes on when I have visitors to visit it.
Okay.
It's not on all day long, so it's not bad.
Have you ever thought about like opening it as an attraction to people?
I'll let anybody come by to see it if they want to.
Okay.
Yes.
So if anybody actually wants to come and see it, they can contact Chuck through us and stop by and take a look. I see on the furniture over there, there's pictures of your grandchildren. So I'm just kind of wondering, what do they make of it all?
When they were smaller, they loved it. I still have a four-year-old that still comes down here, and he walks around and he turns everything on. He knows how to turn it on and off.
Yeah.
And he has a little ladder that he climbs on so he can climb up and see everything.
Yeah. No, it really is something to behold. It's a bit like coming into a winter wonderland, you know, really. I remember when I used to go and see Santa Claus as a kid, they would take you into like the grotto, and it was like being in a completely different world. And coming into Chuck's kind of like Coronaville here, it is really like coming into a winter wonderland. So Chuck, you're a big baker, you're a big cook, and you're a big hobbyist here with the Corona villages. I also know that you're very, very active in terms of your exercise. I believe you go biking, right?
I bike on my, in the wintertime, I do about 5 miles on the bike, and I work with the dumbbells to keep myself in shape.
So Chuck does 5 miles a day on his stationary bike here, and he uses dumbbells to keep himself fit. A good example to all of us, an encouragement to all of us, you know. But do you not get bored when you're on the bike?
No, I read books while I'm pedaling.
You know, I used to go to the gym, you know, and try and sort of take a book with me while I was on the exercise machine. But I could not focus on what was on the page of the book while I was doing the exercise. But Chuck manages to do it, you know, really. May I ask you, are you reading anything which is of particular interest at this time?
No, I've got, right this moment, I'm reading this, Jack Preacher, I'm reading this one, I'm just about finished with this one.
Listen, you are a man after my father's own heart, because, you know, the only books he will read are Jack Reacher books by Lee Child. So I know that he gets great pleasure out of that. And generally, when he comes to visit me here in Chicago, he always brings a couple of Jack Reacher books to read. So it's a good kind of good action-packed bit of mystery, bit of suspense. And so there you go. Another Jack Reacher fan here too. Glad to hear it. So anyway, let's go and move along to the next section, the final section here. the final three tables here, and I suppose the piece which is of the best interest here would be, at least for me, is the fun fair, the carnival, right? But maybe you have more to say about that than I do.
The carnival was built next to a church because of the church that always has a carnival. So I put that here, and it has merry-go-rounds, tilt-the-whirl, parachutes, the big top, Halloween haunted house. It has a farm in the background, and just everything that's possible.
Not sure if you picked up that, but the inspiration for his carnival here is the family fest at Church of the Holy Spirit. And he's sort of saying in the background is the church, and then be in front of the church, you've got the carnival here with everything else and all its different attractions. And you know, obviously the family fest. Built on the parking lot. Even here, the parking spaces with the yellow lines. It's CHS, it's Church of the Holy Spirit. So obviously, you know, Chuck is a committed member, not just of the Church Universal, but specifically of the Church of the Holy Spirit. And obviously the family fest that we haven't been able to have this year, but I know it's scheduled to happen next year, and I'm looking forward to experiencing it for the very, very first time. Can you tell me, Chuck, you know, how long you've been a parishioner here at Church of the Holy Spirit?
Probably 15 years at least.
Okay.
My wife was very involved in it. She was a caretaker. She was part of the, she was part of everything. She was very involved, and I was partly involved in it too. And when she passed 2.5 years ago, I joined the choir.
So it was really in some ways through your wife's involvement that it kind of drew you more in to be more active. Yeah, may I ask your wife's name? I never knew her. Sorry?
Linda.
So Linda, you may remember her, Linda, and remember her fondly, but through Linda's involvement, so Chuck became more committed as a member of the Church of the Holy Spirit. And he's just mentioned that he's a member of the church choir, which I've yet to witness, I've yet to see and experience, but that's obviously something, that's another string to his bow and another part of his life here, which is a wonderful thing. But you've been here for like in the parish for 15 years or so,
at least,
and probably more than that, right, yeah. And you may not know this, but like Chuck comes to our daily mass every day, you know, when we have mass. And I also know that he comes on a Saturday night, and he also comes on a Sunday morning as well. So he gets his full dose of religion, full dose of faith. And I know that especially Chuck, during these Advent days of a morning, he's the person who lights the candles on the wreath for us, right? Yes. He lights the Advent candles for us every day. Well, it's really a joy to be a part of this here with you and to have this for everybody else to see, you know. As I say, I'm on this exciting adventure of getting to know different people in the parish. There's one thing that Chuck hasn't revealed about himself to us, which I know, and he has in great in common with my own father. And I know that Chuck is a big devotee and fan of ice cream.
Yes.
Chuck likes ice cream. And I know, like my father, if he could, he would eat ice cream every day. I wouldn't be surprised if Chuck eats ice cream most days, right?
Most days, yes. I have to keep some ice cream in for my smallest grandson. But the first thing he does when he comes here on Thursday and Saturday is go to the refrigerator and get an ice cream.
It's great that your grandchildren are able to come here and to enjoy this with you, you know. But in some ways, you're setting out before us a great kind of way of life that we all need to, I suppose, have in place you know, which involves a certain commitment to sort of work and doing something constructive, exercise, you know, eating well, you know, a good dose of religion, a good dose of God. We all need that. And then, you know, the fun bits too, you know, the ice cream bits. I know I've been to breakfast with Chuck on a number of occasions these recent months, and he always has, like, whatever he orders, a waffle or pancakes or anything, it always comes with ice cream on the side if they're serving it. And that's for breakfast. And that's just a great fun thing to do, you know, that Chuck, you enjoy your life, you know, and the blessings which God has given you, you know, the blessings of a wonderful life with your wife, Linda, in the church, and now the blessings you have of your grandchildren and your own children. So, you know, on behalf of Church of the Holy Spirit here today, and most of all, you know, Chuck Corona, you know, I want to wish you all a very joyful Advent as we journey through these days to Christmas, and a very festive time. And really, you know, be inspired by the example that Chuck gives us here, and these wonderful villages, the things you can do creatively, you know, and not necessarily spend your life savings. You know, obviously, garage sales are a great source, and I think I'll be looking for them myself. And if I see one of these village houses, I know that I'll be picking it up to bring it here too. Thank you for your hospitality, and Jonah's here too as well. And I know that we're going to go and get some of your cookies from you now. So we'll be signing off for now. Enjoy the rest of your day. Enjoy the rest of Advent, and we'll be in touch. Peace. Keep the faith, and cheers.